So, I recently did a full playthrough of The Legend of Zelda Phantom Hourglass on my stream, and this is a game that a lot of people ask me what I think about. Both Phantom Hourglass and Spirit Tracks are two games that a lot of people have very fond memories of as a kid. However, even though I own them, I never beat them. I didn't even come halfway through the game because they were too difficult for me as a kid to beat. So I thought I would go in with a blind playthrough, never watching this game completed with no spoilers, and kind of just see what I thought about it. And spoiler alert, I absolutely loved Phantom Hourglass. So what I thought I would do today is go over the things that I really liked about the game, things I didn't like as much, and some things that could have aged better since this game was released, looking at a 2020 standard. I also would like to say that I was playing this on the Wii U Virtual Console. If you don't know, DS actually has Virtual Console on the Wii U. So this is the original game, but on Virtual Console. It is upscaled to 1080p, but the models are still very low polygon since it is a DS game after all, so I'm sorry for the graphics in advance. But without further ado, let's get right into it. So the first thing you're going to notice the second you spawn into the game is that this game has a very different approach to the movement mechanic. Normally, you would be controlling Link with a D-pad or an analog stick, but in this game, it is entirely done with the stylus pen. Basically, if you hold a direction, Link will walk. You have to tap an enemy or slash your sword, or slash your stylus, I should say, to make a slash, or spin a circle around Link to do a quick spin. And this definitely took a little bit of time to get used to, and I thought I would hate playing through this game because I immediately absolutely despised playing like this. However, the good thing I have to say is that after only about an hour and a half to maybe 2 hours of playing this game, I was fully used to it, and I didn't even think about the fact that it was annoying to have to play like that, and it really isn't that bad when you get into it and you get used to the mechanics, so it actually is not as bad as people might remember if you give it a chance. The other thing that I would like to talk about the stylus pen and why I also am a very big defender of it is kind of when it comes to people that defend Skyward Sword. As a lot of you might know, I'm not a huge fan of Skyward Sword myself, but one thing that a lot of people that do like it do give credit for is that the motion controls allowed to give you a lot of more gameplay mechanics. In this specific scenario, they took it to a whole other level, and there's a lot of different puzzles and items that uses the stylus pen in a very, very smart way. And that's what I want to talk to right now. The item design. The items has to be one of my favorite in Phantom Hourglass. One of the easiest thing is the boomerang. The boomerang has been in a lot of different Zelda games, and it works very simply. You throw it, it goes forward, and then it kind of comes back to you in a circle shape. And in some games, you can target to something, and it then follows a path, but then it comes back to you. In Phantom Hourglass, you can draw with your stylus pen exactly the path you want it to be, and you can draw this really far. You can draw it in circles, you can draw it around ledges, which gives you a lot more opportunities for puzzles. A very easy example one is when there's switches. Sometimes you need to hit switches in a specific order, so you need to draw them in a specific order, and it's time-based, so you can't also draw too badly with the boomerang. And this adds for another just like cool little mechanic of just like hitting switches in a specific order with the boomerang. And these are just some things that I really did enjoy. And this exists both in Spirit Tracks and Phantom Hourglass. So I thought this was really cool. Another example of when they took an item that was in a previous game and then changed it entirely in this game was the grappling hook. The grappling hook is obviously from the original Wind Waker, since if you don't know, this is a follow-up from Wind Waker. This is the Wind Waker 2, basically. It continues the story right after Wind Waker 1 left off. And in this game, the grappling hook works entirely differently. They basically combined the hook shot and the grappling hook and added new mechanics to it. So what am I talking about? Well, for example, if you mark a pole or a chest or something with the grappling hook, you will go directly to it just like the hook shot. But you can also, with your stylus pen, draw from one pole to another pole, and you will now make a rope appear from the grappling hook, and you can now walk on top of it, which is another really cool mechanic. You can also grab things with the grappling hook in a similar way of what the whip works. And on top of that as well, and my favorite thing about it, is that it goes even further beyond that, because now you can, in very smart manners, make it so that you make a rope in between two platforms, and then you walk into the rope, which gives you like an extra jump. It's basically like bouncing you away in the opposite direction where you're walking into the rope, which is just another amazing mechanic that the grappling hook allows you to have. And you can make some really cool and smart puzzles with this mechanic in mind. And I absolutely love that they took an already existing item and expanded it very far thanks to the stylus pen. Another example, and it's going to be the last example of items, is the hammer. The skull hammer, which existed in Wind Waker, the Megaton hammer in Ocarina of Time, and a bunch of other Zelda games has a hammer, and it works very simply. Just a hammer you slam and you can hit switches that are more heavy. In this game, it works differently. Here, you actually like using it as a combat item in a lot of situations, unlike the hammers in other Zelda games. Because here, when you take out the hammer, the actual fairy itself is what's holding the hammer, so you can actually move it to any part of the screen you want, and where you release it is where the hammer is gonna actually slam down. And you can also hold it in to make it bigger so that it does more damage or it can have some special effects throughout the game. And this is another example of an item they took and completely changed how it works. There's a lot of other situations as well of new innovating items, but I think those one kind of just goes over why it opens up a lot of cool possibilities being on the DS. Another thing I really want to focus on that I really loved about Phantom Hourglass was the bosses. The bosses in both Phantom Hourglass and Spirit Tracks are absolutely amazing. Some of them are straight 2D, and some of them are a mix match in between 2D and 3D. And overall, a lot of the mechanics are actually really, really cool. Now, there are some things that I didn't particularly enjoy, and I think that Wind Waker did better. So I want to get into some of the negatives, but the negatives definitely don't outweigh the positives. The negatives I would have to say in this game, and what most people feel like, is one, the overworld. I don't mind sailing around in the overworld, but I do wish that the actual warp song you get in this game was a little bit more similar to how it worked in the original Wind Waker. In the Wind Waker, when you get Wind's Requiem, you can just select one of 8 locations to warp to, and that's it. Here, after you unlock the actual plate, which allows you to use the warp feature, you have to find these golden frogs, shoot them, and then they will teach you basically a symbol of how to draw it. And this drawing is pretty specific. You have to draw it from the right way. It's not just making the shape. You have to do it, like, for example, it can't be from bottom to top or top to bottom. It has to be exactly the way they drew it. And it can be a little bit annoying, and also sometimes if you fail to kill the golden frog, then it doesn't respawn even if you really leave the ocean, and you don't really understand why he doesn't come back, and it just takes a while. So if you miss one, you still have to sail around a bunch. So that's something that's a nitpick that I would like to see improved. Another thing that I wasn't a huge fan of was actually the fact that in Phantom Hourglass, the music is definitely lacking. Now, they definitely upped this in Spirit Tracks, and I'll be talking about that in my Spirit Tracks review for 2020, but this is definitely something that definitely they could have improved on. The music was not something that I found to be very enjoyable to listen to. And the last thing, and this is actually going to be more of a counter-argument than anything, is the tower, the dreadful tower that everyone talks about, where you get sand, you get the Phantom Hourglass, and you have to go up in this tower over and over and over and over again 4 or 5 times to continue to unlock new charts to get further into the game. Now, this was one of the main things I heard that people disliked about this game, and the first time I entered, I was like, okay, this is not going to be a lot of fun having to re-go through these floors. But what I realized when I came back, and I think this is what a lot of people might have missed as a kid, is that if you are paying attention when you're going through it the first time, you'll find a lot of switches. For example, like a switch where you can shoot an eye, which means that if you get the bow, you can hit it. Or these holes that you could have used bomb chews through that you didn't have them the first time you came around. Or walls, which you can bomb now when you have bombs. And what this allows you to do is replay the towers in a completely different way and just do a bunch of shortcuts. And the game is intended for this. Easy example is there's some floors where you have to get a small key, and it takes a very long time and it's annoying to get the small key. But what you can do instead is get the small key on an earlier floor, then use the items you obtained to use the shortcuts to get up to the top floors, and then use the small key on the later floors, allowing you to skip most of the annoying stuff entirely, making it kind of a fun speedrun to run through it. And there's also a bunch of chests you can find and different ways of doing things in the floors that actually makes you want to go through them again to find the chest that you missed, because now with more items, you have a lot of secrets scattered around. So I actually found this to be quite fun to go through the tower, so it really is not a big complaint for me. Now, the main thing that you might be wondering as well is, so playing this in 2020, what doesn't hold up to this day? Now, I actually really don't mind the stylus, and that was what I thought would be my number one complaint about this when I played through it, but I really won't even put that as a main complaint, because I got used to it so quickly that I really didn't find it to be that bad. The few things I would like to, I guess, then age as well would definitely be the graphics. The fact that they attempted a 3D game on this kind of version didn't hold up as well as it could have done. So that's definitely something that you kind of have to get used to in the rendering distance. Thankfully, they did actually improve the graphics drastically in the Spirit Tracks version of this game. Just the Link model alone looks way better. But it's kind of like playing old games. When you get used to the graphics, you stop thinking about it. But I saw a lot of people when they joined the stream complain about the graphics. So that's definitely something that I could see them improving. But otherwise, I'm happy to say that for 2020, I think the only complaint that I would like them to improve if they've remade this game was the music, the warp system, and the graphics, which is actually not that big of a complaint. So I think this game actually holds up amazingly for 2020, way better than I thought. And now we're getting into a bit of a spoiler territory. If you want to skip forward, the timestamp will be on your screen right now. But I want to talk about the final sequence of the game, the boss fight and the final boss fight and that whole sequence. It has to be one of my favorite ending sequence out of any Zelda game. I remember the first time I played Breath of the Wild, I was actually quite disappointed by the final boss, because if you beat the Divine and Beast, which you most likely did in your playthrough, it wasn't that great, honestly. Like, Calamity Ganon, it wasn't too hard to do, and the Dark Beast is literally an auto-scroller. It's just set on timer, you can't fail it, even if you die or respawn there. It's not that difficult, and it's not that much fun. In this game, however, it's very different. You go from one boss, and then it changes floor, and you have to do it differently, and then another floor, and it's like a 3D section, it's super cool, and then you get put out, and you think, oh, well, you did it, but then, like, there's a plot twist, and then you go back to, like, the ghost ship, and you chase the ghost ship, and then Linebeck, which you've kind of seen story development over the game, and you kind of start to get, like, actually like as a character. He, you know, rescues and saves the day, and then he gets captured and becomes evil, and just the whole sequence in general is just absolutely amazing. It has to be one of the most enjoyable endgame sequences of any Zelda game that I've ever played, gameplay-wise, that is. Story-wise, definitely, I mean, it's a Zelda game, it's not its strong point, but I would still say the story was very good. So overall, one of my favorite endgames. Now, to my conclusion of what I think about this game in 2020. This is now my favorite 2D Zelda game that I played. If you consider this a 2D Zelda, it actually beats A Link to the Past for me. I had so much fun with this playthrough, and despite it being lacking in some fronts, I really enjoyed it. I really think that this is a very underrated Zelda game, and if you own a Wii U or DS, I really recommend you pick it up. When you get past the stylus kind of annoyance after an hour or two, it's so much fun. The puzzles are some of the best in any Zelda game. The dungeons are amazing, the bosses are amazing, and honestly, overall, this was just such a fun experience to play through. Now, if you don't own a DS or a Wii U and you are interested in watching a full playthrough, I will have my highlight video number 1 and 2 linked in the description. I have a full playthrough. The playthrough is about 16 hours or so, and I have a full playthrough from the entire game, beating about 70-80% of it. I beat the whole story, but about 70-80% entirely, I would say. Doing a good amount of the side quests, but not all of them. So if you want to watch a full playthrough of that, I definitely recommend you to check it out. And I'm also going to be doing a full review of Spirit Tracks, which I'm actually going to be finishing on Sunday on my Twitch channel. I am right in the end of the game. And then I'm going to be giving you guys a review and honest opinions about how Spirit Tracks holds up in 2020. And I have a lot more things to say about Spirit Tracks, because Spirit Tracks is a lot more of a mixed bag for me, to say the least. But without further ado, thank you guys so much for watching this video. I really hope you enjoyed it. And I'll see you all in the next one. Later, everybody. Bye-bye.